I think we have a few more people that might still be looking for seats. If I could ask a favor, if you could, everybody kind of move, well, I guess we're almost there, but if you have an extra seat next to you, could you raise your hand real quickly so the ushers could kind of see where, so there's an expensive one up here, and I guess there's really a prime, this is, there's two more here, so the ushers, if you can kind of keep an eye for the ones who come in late, there's still a few seats. Okay, we are going to launch. I want to, my name is Jamie Hansen. I'm the pastor of The Well, and Greg was a part of our church for the last several years. And I want to welcome all of you to this. Yes, it's a memorial, but this is a celebration of Greg's life. And there's a big difference between a funeral and a celebration, and I'm sure you'll catch that during this time today. Could we all stand up? I know you will be sitting for a bit. Heavenly Father, we thank you today. We love you for everything that you are and everything that you became to Greg. And I was just thinking we should celebrate Heavenly Father's Day tomorrow, because you are a heavenly, perfect Father. And so, Lord, I pray that during these few minutes we have together, that your own presence and the love that Greg found in you will fill this place today, as we realize he is not dead. He is finally alive, completely alive. And what he lived for, he's experiencing. And so, Lord, I pray your love and your joy, and also the seriousness of mortality, will fill this place today. And we thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. And Doug Bunger is going to open with a song.
If I don't get tangled up in the snake. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by his nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. I'd rather have Jesus than man's applause. I'd rather be faithful to his dear cause. I'd rather have Jesus than worldwide fame. I'd rather be true to his holy name than to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. He's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He's sweeter than honey from out the comb. He's all that my hungering spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus and let him lead than to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
They shortened my podium. I'm going to have trouble here. That was beautiful. If we have any important announcements, we're going to have you do those, Doug. So, I know for some people, memorials that we typically have here are really shocking because, yes, like for Christine and all of us, we really miss Greg. I remember at my dad's memorial, it was like I tried to feel sad and I couldn't because I knew he was alive. And so I wanted to mention a couple quick quotes. Garrison Keillor said, "They say such nice things about people at their funerals, it makes me sad to realize I'm going to miss mine by just a few days." and I think it was Jeff Goldblum that said, "Memorials are strange because they throw the greatest party ever for you on the one day you can't make it." I witnessed in Greg's life, there's a verse in the Bible that says, it talks about the renewing of our mind, and the literal language carries the meaning of getting young again in your mind. And I saw that in Greg's life. I saw him getting younger and wanting more out of life than he used to. And that's a pretty remarkable thing. And I want to encourage you right up front so I don't forget. I think people get old when they stop being curious. And then life gets to be a real drag. And so stay curious in your life. It's a very powerful thing. And I know I've heard so many people in life say, you know, yeah, Greg got religion. You know, hey, that guy got religion. But Greg didn't get religion. And I'll say this because it's important. Religion is a humanly created thing, and it always produces the same result: fog, fear, obligation, and guilt. That's what religion produces. But Greg had a living, actual relationship with Jesus Christ every day. And Greg wasn't perfect. Christine, it's okay. You know, we already know. It's okay. But Greg was willing to let God work in his life. And I watched him being changed and go through tests and challenges. And that's an amazing thing, to be willing to do that. And there's a verse in Philippians 1:21 that says, "For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." That seems so non sequitur, that to die is actually gain. But it's a powerful thing to have a pattern to live by, which Jesus Christ is our pattern. He was Greg's pattern. And there are millions and hundreds of millions of people that are so broken and so perplexed and sad because they have no pattern. They're just going with whatever culture tells them, and they're sad and they feel like a failure, or they feel arrogant, whatever it is. But having a pattern is a very powerful thing in life. And I think memorial services allow us a chance to stop and have perspective about life. And I know a lot of people hate memorial services. They don't want to go. And part of it is, it gives us perspective that maybe burnt toast or the traffic in Seattle or hay fever aren't as huge a thing as we make them a lot of times. We get to stop and go, wow, life. Wow. What is really important? And there's this thing called the tyranny of urgency that I think most of us live with, and we run, especially Americans. And so Solomon, the wisest man that ever lived, said, it is far better to go into the house of mourning than into the house of partying. Because he said, in the house of mourning, we stop and actually consider our lives. And that's one reason people don't like memorials, because they actually confront that we want to get away with ignoring eternity. We want to get away with it. And memorials sort of stop us and say, what is your life? What are these days meaning? And they also are, because it's really important. The Bible says to rejoice with those that rejoice and weep with those that are weeping. It gives us a chance to really embrace those that are feeling that tearing loss. And Christine was married to Greg for a long time. And there's children and grandchildren. And we miss that person really deeply. And so it's a chance for us to remember their life. And Greg used to crack me up just because of his personality. He was so laid back, and then every once in a while he'd lay these zingers on me that would just crack me up. I'm sure you experienced those. In this little tiny message today, I'm not going to apologize for how it might come across, because every time I get to speak at a memorial, I feel like it's such an incredible privilege because of the atmosphere. And I am only speaking today what I believe Greg would want me to say, except he would say it with way more passion and way more intensity than I ever could if he could speak from where he is right now. And so I'm just the messenger. But here's the assumptions in this message. There really is a God. There's a real God. And you are not him, and neither am I. But he's real. And it's such a, I like to show people like an iPad or my cell phone, and I like, especially young people, I like to tell them that this right here, nobody designed it. There was a bunch of chemicals in this building that was built like 400 years ago, right when people came to America, and there was a lot of chemicals in that area, and a lot of wind and lightning, and it was a swampy, weird area that just kind of got, a little house was built there and abandoned for hundreds of years. And through all of that, this just came out of that. It's really weird. Nobody designed this. Do you guys buy that? This just happened. I mean, I'm serious. None of you believe that. What about this? This is like a rock compared to you. Your eyes can process 6 billion bits of information in 1 second, and that just happened? We can make other living beings? No, there's a God. So the other important thing is he loves us. He loves like no human's love. And I've experienced that love, and many of you have. There's an old saying, nobody's ready to live until they're ready to die. And what's sad to me, I used to work with retirees for 30 years helping them plan. And what's sad to me is most people spend 100 times more time planning for their retirement than for eternity. A lot of people spend more time shopping for a lawnmower than thinking about eternity. That's pretty stunning, really. And I like to ask people, where do you see yourself 5 years from now? How about 10 years from now? How about 300 years from now? It's worth the consideration. By the way, it's way harder to talk for 10 or 12 minutes than a half hour. But so is it just Seahawks getting high, chasing the girls, the gold, the glory? I think there's bigger reasons for our life. I'm going to end with this. I know it's hard for people to understand a memorial service where there's so much joy, like I said before, but the reality that Greg is only going to experience joy and peace that keeps growing and growing, and never pressure and stress ever again. That's real. That's as real as us here right now today. And none of us are ready to live until we're ready to die. Otherwise, that's always hanging over right here. Doesn't matter how much success you have, it's sitting there hanging over. And the last thing I'll say is, if we went out to the cemetery right now together and looked at 100 tombstones, there's one thing on every tombstone. One thing. There's a name and maybe a little saying. And then there's what'll be on mine is Jamie Hansen, August 22nd, 1953. And then there's a dash. And then there's the year of death. And the only thing we have while we're alive is that dash. It's really small. It goes by really fast. And so you and I are living in our dash right now today. Greg had his, and we have just the dash. And so I want to encourage you, and I know Greg would, that if you've never allowed yourself to really consider if there's a God, what could be greater than knowing him? I went hitchhiking at 18, smoking weed, just trying to run. And I came to the point, because I had been raised in a Christian home, and I said, I felt like I was coming to the end of a valley. Either I'm going to go all in and live for God, or I'm going to just party, you know, party till I drop. But I want to urge you to consider that God loves you and wants you to know him. And he's a better friend than any you've ever had. And he wants to give us eternal life. And it's a free gift that came through a horrible price through what Jesus did for us. And so I just want to encourage you, if you've never let yourself think about it, maybe today is a perfect day. And if you have any questions, there's a lot of people here, and I'd be happy to talk to you. But let's enjoy the rest of this memorial. And I want to just say there's about 10 family members that are going to share here some memories. And because of that, we're not going to just open it up. They'll be sharing the memories today. And I want to invite those that are going to be sharing, if you'd like, it might be time efficient if you wanted to come and sit on the bench here. And then as soon as one is done, you can just pop right up. If you don't want to, that's fine. But I'd like to invite you to come and sit up here, those that are going to be speaking. I was going to do this at the end, I thought. I want to read a letter from Lauren that he wrote. Greg and I were both born in Yakima. As you will see from the stories I share, Greg was the adventurous one, and I was the older brother. We lived in Yakima with our parents. You know what? Get to be a mature teenager in these things. Okay. Since Greg was a younger brother, he often tagged along with me and my friends, always on his own time frame and pace. I particularly remember a day when my friends and I were going on the Big Blue River in Beatrice, Nebraska, and Greg insisted on bringing his little Pekingese puppy on a leash while riding a bike. He was behind and all over the place trying to manage his puppy. When we got to the river, he talked us into going into the river and fishing on top of a large baling wire spool that had lodged in the river and looked pretty stable. Soon we were all in on this spool. Greg's line pulled and he had a bite, and of course we all got excited, but none as excited as the little dog. The puppy immediately jumped into the river off the spool, with Greg following after, then the rest of us one at a time. A fishing day to remember for sure. Other summer memories in Nebraska with Greg are catching fireflies and pinching the light parts off so our fingers would light up, and burning anthills with a magnifying, I'm sure Greg never did this, with a magnifying glass. We were always outside, and those were the good old days without electronics to entertain us. When my mother passed away in 1967, we left Nebraska to live with relatives in Stockton, California. After 2 years there and a visit back to Yakima, we were asked by Uncle Howard if we would like to move back to Yakima. It was an enthusiastic yes. We were excited to be back, lived with Grandma Bunger for a year. I proceeded to go to college, and Greg lived with Uncle Howard and Aunt Marge to finish high school in Tacoma. My memories with Greg and Uncle Howard are priceless. We went on a backpacking trip one summer, and it was quite a hike. It was Greg, Steve, Uncle Howard, and I. Uncle Howard was concerned because every time he turned around to check on us, Greg was getting into his backpack for a snack. Sure enough, by the time we reached our destination, all of Greg's food was gone, and Greg was shocked to have an empty backpack. On another deer hunting trip, Uncle Howard drove the same group. On the way, we got a flat tire. Uncle Howard unloaded us and told us he was going to get the tire fixed. Shortly after he left, Greg and Steve feared they would starve to death, so they killed a squirrel. These guys would be in jail today, but and decided they were going to start a fire and cook it for food. With the fire burning and the squirrel on a stick, they were about to eat it just as Uncle Howard returned. Luckily, he was able to stop the dinner and kept him from eating it. While I was in college, Greg went through a foosball phase and spent every bit of free time playing foosball. He was really good at it, as he was at all things he put his mind to. He did raise a few eyebrows when he made the announcement he was going to go professional. Thankfully, that never happened. When Greg and Chris found each other, it was a real blessing, as together they raised two wonderful daughters, which made him a great husband, father, and grandfather. He was always so wonderful to reach out to us, and we never doubted his love. We will sure miss him. So we're going to have a living eulogy now. And so if you'd like to come up here, and we'll start with Marge.
Can you hear me okay?
No, you gotta hold it.
All right.
And hold it right up.
I don't want it right up here.
I mean, I'm the microphone Nazi.
Okay. Greg came to live with us when we moved from Sealer to Tacoma. He was 15. He had lost his father when he was 2, his mother when he was 12, and now we moved him to Tacoma and left his brother to live with Grandma Bunger to finish high school in Sela. Then, add to that that Greg was 5 years older than our daughter, our older daughter, so I expected him to be that much more responsible. When he preferred to be treated more like our 7-year-old. To say the least, he was a frustrated, unhappy young man. One day he came home from school and wanted to go to his friend's house, and I said no. We argued a bit, and he raised his fist as if he was going to hit me, and I said, go ahead, hit me, but make it a good one because you're only going to get one shot. He backed down, and we never had another problem. Not that we always agreed. Greg made friends easily, and a group of them decided they wanted to form a recreational basketball team, but needed a coach. So Howard, who had never played basketball, became the coach. I don't think they ever won a game, but for 2 years they had fun. We spent every other weekend in Sela, and he spent all of his school breaks there with his brother and all the cousins that lived in Sela. There were many fishing and picnic trips to Lake Kapausen and camping trips with cousins and uncles. Some trips were backpacking to a favorite lake on Chinook Pass, the first of which Uncle Morris put all the heavy cooking pans in the boys' packs. And after that, they were sure to pack their own packs. Uncle Frank and Aunt Joyce had a boat and would take their 4 children and the boys to Bumping Lake, Rim Rock, or the Potholes, where they fished, swam, and learned to water ski. When Howard got transferred to Bellevue and we bought the house in Issaquah, Greg stayed in Tacoma with 4 friends in an apartment to go to college, but spent more time playing foosball in the commons than attending class. He passed his calculus class without attending class. He went to the first class to get the syllabus and the last class to take the final exam. Howard bought a chainsaw when Greg was living in Tacoma, and Greg asked him, "Why didn't you buy it when I lived with you?" And Howard said, "I didn't need it then." He had Greg to do all of his logging. Not long after we got settled in Issaquah, Greg came over and said he needed to come home because it wasn't working out in the apartment. We were in a three-bedroom house, now with three girls, so everyone pitched in to convert the carport into a bedroom and a family room. Now our family was whole again. He remained with us until Chris came into his life. Greg bought a little red sports car and brought it to show us, and Howard warned him to watch the speed because that was the kind of car that caught the patrolman's attention. And Greg's answer was, "It's so low, it goes right under the radar." We never heard that again, and the little red sports car was soon replaced with something more conservative. He grew up to be the loving, kind friend that you all know. Often expressing his gratitude and love for us and our love and help. We're really going to miss him.
I don't know if I can do this, but I'll try. I'm the oldest cousin on my dad's side of the family, so I have, supposedly they said I had the longest memory, but they lied. So I remember Greg from a child, being a child, and going on picnics with Grandma and Grandpa and my parents. And when we ride home, Greg and I would get to sit, and Grandma would sit in the back seat with us, and we got to share her pillows. Now, do you know what the cousins will know what those are. I don't have to be too specific. But anyway, I remember, it's hard to remember back that far. I'll be 77 this year, so things fade. I do remember Uncle Lauren vividly. And Greg has the exact sense of humor that his dad had. He was gregarious and happy most of the time, and had a heart as big as this world. I got to know him better when we went to Aunt Louise's 90th birthday party, and then he and Chris and I went to the wine country. And I learned some things that they talked about that I didn't know were descriptions. They described a caw. Chris is laughing. I don't know. Probably shouldn't say that, should I? Okay, Chris says no. Okay. Anyway, it was interesting. Ask me later. I'll tell you. But anyway, we had a great time. We just saw the country and piddled and didn't do a whole lot. And it was a great trip. So, and then I've gotten to talk to him quite a bit. We used to talk on the phone a lot. I just remember Uncle Lauren coming to have coffee with my mom and dad, and they traded baby clothes back and forth. And it was just, you know, it was a great, they had a great family. We're very lucky we had that family. We have a lot to be grateful for with our grandparents. Oh, the basement steps. Yes. Anyway, when he was about, how old were they, Pete? 12, 14. 4th of July came around, and he was there, and he came down, and he and my brother, who were pretty close to the same age, they were with us. We were going somewhere for the 4th of July. And we rented a duplex. We'd just gotten married, and to get to the basement where the laundry was, we had to go out the back door and down these steps and then into the basement. Well, Greg and my brother Doug would throw smoke bombs down in the basement stairwell when I was in there, and then I'd come out and there'd be all this smoke. And then they would roll on the ground and laugh. But anyway, he was just always this little boy with a great big heart, a great sense of humor, and I loved him dearly. So, you know, I know he's happy where he is, but he will be greatly missed.
Hi, I'm one of Greg's cousins, and that was living in Selah, so I was involved in all of the jaunts we did in Selah. And I'm here to talk more about a little later in life after him and Chris had gotten married. And we had just many, many adventures together. And I'm just gonna highlight just a few of them. One of the big ones we did is we played Pinochle. And anytime we got a chance, we played Pinochle. And we have played Pinochle all over the U.S., Mexico, just everywhere. And some of the places we went is we went to Hawaii, to the Big Island. And we didn't do little adventures. We always did some big event while we were gone. And while we were there, it was like, okay, we have a volcano that's blowing, right? So this is a good time, let's go find the volcano. So we decided to take a helicopter ride, but we couldn't do just a normal one. We had to do one that they take all the doors off the helicopter. And then we drove and went around the volcano, and the pilot would just angle down and we could take our pictures. And it was a big hoot, but that was, you know, that was Greg, talked to adventurous. He did not lose that. another time we went to Cancun right after Wilma had gone through and destroyed many of the nice, fabulous resorts. And Chris had a friend's brother who was working at one. And so we went down there. And to our luck, some of the big resorts, one of the chefs was at the one that we went to while they were rebuilding his. And Greg, if people know Greg, they know he likes to cook. And he is a fabulous cook. But that he could not rave enough about that chef. And we had to eat every single meal we could with that chef because it was so good. And so that was fun. And then I'm kind of adventurous too, because I suggested, well, you know, let's go do an adventure. So I said, I've never ziplined. I'd like to go zipline. And so Greg, Chris, my husband, Roger, we all decided, sure, let's go ziplining. So we had to ride a bike up a hill. And then the zipline was very primitive. But it was like your brake was a branch that had an angle on it, and you had to put it, I still don't remember, was it in front or in back? In front of the roller. And so now my husband has one arm that doesn't work well. And so at first we knew we were having troubles when he arrives sideways because he couldn't hold on and put a brake on. And so of course Greg's kind of, what did you say Greg said to you? You're either dumb or... Yeah, incredibly brave or awfully stupid of being out on a zip line. And then we get to the end. It was my turn to go first, and I'm going to take pictures of everyone coming across. And I think I gave them all a little surprise because I put my thing behind me, and they yelled at me. I put it instead of in front on top of the thing. And we go sailing down to the wood platform that you had to raise your legs up for, but I'm not stopping. And so knocked my shoe off, and I'm looking down for it, and they all thought I had died because I had hit the platform. But anyway, that I'm all well. I survived that. But, you know, we just had to do something for fun. So we went to Calgary one winter because that's when we could get flights. And doesn't everybody want to go to Calgary when it's way below zero, you know? Why not? And I remember that we were going on a walk, and they had covered walkways in Calgary, so you could go up and be relatively warm while walking around. But Greg, he didn't have a hat. We went and bought hat and gloves, and I remember Greg saying, well, let's walk outside. And we're going, because you didn't have a hat on. Oh, no, he was, you know, Greg. And so it didn't take us very long before Greg's going, let's go to the next entrance to the covered walkway, because even he couldn't handle that cold, cold weather. But because we were watching, I mean, his ears were turning funny colors and stuff. So we just, like I said, had a great time. When we went to Alaska, that was a highlight. And I know he's done Alaska with others, and you're going to probably hear a little about that. But he had set up a guided drift boat adventure, and because we were going to catch some salmon, and we were all for it because, you know, I'd love to go catch some salmon. Well, we get there and we find out, because we had ups and downs, that they had opened it up and it had been totally netted out by the locals the day before, and there were no fish in the river. It was a beautiful day. I got some great pictures, but we didn't get any fish. And so it was kind of disappointing, but, you know, that's what adventures are. You don't know how they're going to what's going to happen. Another place we went was Palm Springs a couple times. And when we were driving down the freeway to go to the airport, a car goes by and yells at us, your car's on fire. And we're going, what? So we pulled over, and the tailpipe had got bent when we were leaving because we had gone in after unloading all our luggage. But we left the garage with all our luggage in, and they had a kind of a funny little dip, and we heard a scrape, but apparently the pipe had gone up and was melting the back of the car or something. And so anyway, but that was, you know, like I said, if you don't have something to chat about after doing an adventure, it's not an adventure. And oh, we went and visited them when they had their little journey down to South Carolina. And they took us to Myrtle Beach, and we were out swimming in the water. The water was warm. I got Chris out there and showed her how floating on the waves she could do it, because she's not a real water liker. But we were having a great time, and we got to watch fish in the distance that were jumping all over the place until we got a whistle. And it was the lifeguard yelling at us to get out of the water unless we wanted to be shark bait. So apparently there were sharks out in the water, and that was what we were seeing swimming past us. So I even looked it up online, and some kid had gotten bit a week before. So, but that was one of our adventures, and gosh. Oh, another one, I can't remember. We went to Mexico, and we ended up at a hotel not anywhere close to Cabo, but I think we were trying to go to Cabo. And at the hotel, you had to take a taxi to do anything. Like even to eat food, you had to take a taxi somewhere. And I remember Greg had, the guy that took us to dinner, he says, well, what are you doing tomorrow? And he goes, well, you know, I'm driving my taxi. And he goes, well, can we rent you for the day? And, you know, I wouldn't have ever thought of doing that because I'm not as worldly. And so we rented the taxi for the day, and we said, well, we'd like to see the beach. I mean, I don't know about you other people in the car, but I was getting worried because he took us on this back road. I would never drive any of my cars on it, and he's in his taxi, and I thought, oh my gosh, is he going to go dump us off somewhere, you know, or whatever. And sure enough, we did end up at a very private beach, and it was quite interesting, but I was a little worried, but Greg, he didn't have any worries, you know. He just had control of the situations, and he just went with the bumps and the raises, and we just had so many great, great adventures with Greg, and we really miss our time with Greg. I don't know who's next.
So I knew Greg a long time. This is hard. Sorry. Well, so Greg and I knew each other for 50 years. And we had a lot of adventures. Just like Sandy says, he loved to go out and about and do things. We've been a lot of hiking, hunting, fishing, camping. I'm just going to make this quick. Pat, who was supposed to speak after me, he's not going to make it here, so his son-in-law asked me to tell a little story about a fishing trip we took to Alaska. We got there midday. We went to the bar. I drank one beer. They drank beers and shots, and next morning we get up at 4 in the morning, and they're a little hungover. We went fishing all day and caught tons of fish. Afterwards, we come back. We had to clean all those fish, vacuum bag them, and put them away. When we got done, those three were done. And I go, what? I figured I'd rub it in a little. And I went, I'm ready to go cut a cord of wood. So Pat looks at me and goes, well, that's because you're in shape. Greg looks up and he says, I'm in shape. Round's a shape. So Pat always laughed about that. Always thought that was pretty funny. And I tried to think of one adventure that says it all about Greg. And he had a big heart, loved everything. I took Greg on his first hunting trip to go hunt deer. We're going to go out and we're going to get ourselves a deer. We went to a spot that had tons of animals. It was a target-rich environment. I posted him up. I said, hide behind this stump right here. And I went up on the hill, went all the way to the other end of the valley and chased some deer his way. Well, as I start getting close, I slowed down. He should have been shooting by now, but he hadn't. Finally, I come out there and I find Greg sitting on top of the stump. What are you doing? He goes, well, he said, I was sitting here behind the stump and I heard something coming through the bushes that I thought was you. So I hid. He goes, and then you came right up to me and you stopped. So he poked his head up looking over the bushes. About 5 feet away, a deer looks at him. And he goes, uh-oh. So he scared the deer and it runs off. So he got all ready and says he was sitting there and here comes another deer and it's walking up and he aims his gun at it. He says, and then it looked at me with them big brown eyes. He said, I couldn't shoot that. And he didn't. And as far as I know, he never did get a deer. So, but that's how he was. He big-hearted guy. He loved everything, loved every minute. And I'm going to miss that guy. He was a good man. He's in a better place now. And I'm happy about that. So, thank you.
I cheated and wrote it down. So, I met Greg in 1990 while working on a Boeing project called Genesis. I was raised in New England. I was in my early 20s, and I had moved clear across the country, away from everyone and everything that I knew for my first software engineering job. It turned out that I was maybe one of four or five women on a project that had over 150 plus people. Because I was a female in a mostly dominated male field, I think this is why Greg took a liking to me. It was almost like a big brother watching out for a kid sister. When you move to a new part of the country, you become very aware of cultural differences and similarities as well. It's the differences that I'm going to expand on, because I believe, or actually I know, they provided Greg with a lot of humor over the years. The obvious differences are accents and terminology of everyday words. For example, in Massachusetts, people tend to drop the letter R in words that require the letter R. And then the most well-known example of this is the phrase, pack the car and the Harvard yard. People in Massachusetts also like to include the letter R in words where they don't belong. So examples are the word idea and the word soda. As an example is, I've got an idea. Let's go pack the car in the Harvard yard and go get a soda. So apparently, inserting the letter R was something that Greg also was familiar with. Greg always pronounced the word Washington as Washington. I would always tell him, Greg, there's no letter R in the word Washington, and he would keep saying Washington, Washington, and we would debate it back and forth. To this day, I don't know if that was solely a Greg thing or if it's a Washingtonian thing, but it was something we bonded over. But what I really think Greg got a big kick out of was my use of different names for everyday items and my use of different terms for everyday meanings. It's safe to say I provided Greg with much humor, and the fact that he could tease me about my innocence and the fact that they were double entendres. Our work project had relocated from Bellevue to Federal Way. Greg was a smoker at the time, as was I. There was a designated smoking section outside the building, and all the smokers would congregate there at certain points of the day. The first time I stopped by Greg's desk, and it was an open area, and I asked him if he wanted to go outside for a quickie. He said the most enthusiastic sure I'd ever heard, and I swear that was the fastest I ever saw him get up from his desk. And it's no small feat, because we all know Greg was a big guy. Immediately, I realized the double entendre of what I had said, how inappropriate it was. I'm stammering, trying to explain, that's not what I meant, and I'm turning beet red, and I'm getting all flustered. And it turns out Greg and all the coworkers knew all along what I meant by quickie, but Greg just laughed and laughed, and he knew he had gotten me. He says, I know, I'm just teasing you. There would be more instances of me making Greg laugh with my double entendres throughout our entire friendship, but I'm not going to share them here. There are children present. His family. It was through my friendship with Greg that I met his gorgeous wife, Christine, and their beautiful daughters, Kate and Kim. Christine and I bonded over a jukebox in downtown Seattle. I think it was somewhere in Pioneer Square, was it? We took turns picking out songs, and we kept gushing over each other's song choices, like, oh my God, you like that song? Oh my God, you like that song? Turns out we have very similar tastes in music. A bunch of us had gathered to play pool, throw darts, and drink beer. And that's where I learned Greg was a very good pool player and an even better dart player. Somehow along the way, I became part of their family. After my part of my project was over, I had moved away. I would come out to for visits, and they also came to New England for visits. Kim had just completed a report on the fertile Connecticut River Valley, which she could recite from memory, and did. And Catherine, turns out it was wait for Kate time, took over 2 hours to get ready to go see Plymouth Rock. So we also went on vacations together. We went to Cabo. We were driving off-road vehicles along the beach and throughout dried out riverbeds and gullies. We learned about which cacti were actually life-saving in the desert and which ones to stay away from, as well as playing cards and relaxing in the hotel bar for hours. I watched the girls grow up from afar, came to weddings when I could. The distance between us may have grown physically, but we always, always stayed in touch. Through it all, you could tell Greg was always very proud of his family. and always let you know he was proud of them. It was and still is an honor to be considered part of it. So now I'm going to share you a few of the memories that I have of Greg. Greg, hands down, made the best smoked salmon ever. When a 10-month-old, that's the only thing your 10-month-old wants to eat, there's no better recommendation than that, and that's all I'm going to say about the smoked salmon. Playing ping pong at work. I'm not sure why, but one day a ping pong table appeared in an empty conference room. Maybe it was brought in as a stress reliever for the project, but all I remember is that it started a very friendly, but very fierce competition amongst all the engineers. And it caused a lot of jealousy with other Boeing projects that heard that the Genesis crowd had a ping pong table at work. I know for a fact I never won a single match against Greg. In fact, I'm not sure I ever succeeded in actually successfully returning a serve to him. He had this annoying habit of being really, really good at everything. Pool, darts, foosball, and now it turns out ping pong. There was one shot that he had in his arsenal that he always killed me with. The spin he put on that ball was very tough to defend. But this particular shot always had the knack of hitting that end of that table and then shooting off in some random direction. Sometimes it would go straight up, you think it's going left and it goes to the right. I probably spent more time retrieving that stupid ping pong ball off the floor than I ever did actually playing him in a game of ping pong. A monthly dart tournament, one of our colleagues from work, Mark, would host a monthly dart game at his house. You'd show up with your darts, your snacks, your drinks, and pay your $3 fee. It was a double elimination tourney style where names were drawn to pair teams together. The winning team split the pot. And if Greg showed up, I knew there was no chance in Hades that I would ever win unless the dart gods showed mercy and paired me randomly with him. That man could pull a hat trick out of you know where. So, I remember staying with them when they lived in their yellow house on 13th Street, Avenue Street, right? There was a wild squirrel who would come and sit on your lap if you fed it Cheez-Its. Because of this, they named the squirrel Cheezer. I don't know if Cheezer was a boy or a girl, but I do remember being in awe of this wild squirrel sitting on my lap as I fed it these nuclear orange crackers. The Peking Walk in Federal Way. There was a local Chinese restaurant that became one of our frequent go-to lunch places. It was relatively inexpensive, but had really, really good food. And I specifically remember one particular lunch. There were six of us seated at a table. The waiter took our order. Greg and a fellow colleague, Rob, both ordered the same dish. I think it was Szechuan beef. Greg ordered his with a heat level of 3. Rob orders his with a heat level of 5. The nice thing about this restaurant is the food came relatively quickly after you placed your order. The waiter brought everybody's food and we proceeded to start eating. Within 2 bites of his food, Greg's face starts to flush, this kind of pink-reddish tinge. And I remember Greg's comment was, "Wow, this is kind of spicy." He took a sip of water and he continued to eat. With each progressive bite, it seemed as Greg's face turned redder and redder. Finally, it was this deep shade of red. After maybe the 5th or 6th bite of food and 2 glasses of water, I see this line appearing on Greg's forehead. It wasn't hard to miss since we all know Greg didn't have much hair up there. Within seconds, the line on his forehead had turned into raging beads of sweat. You could literally see them forming out of his pores, grow into these tiny beads and into these round balls of water. Then gravity took over, and they started running down towards his face. Greg reached for his napkin and started patting at his forehead. Within seconds, that napkin was soaked. Greg then reached for another napkin, and then another napkin, and then another napkin. The beads of sweat had declared war, and no amount of napkins would vanquish them. It was at this point our colleague Rob turned to Greg and simply said, "I think you got my order." In February of 2001, I happened to be in town with my son when the Nisqually earthquake hit. I was on the 15th floor of a 25-story hotel in Bellevue when the earthquake actually started. My son was 10 months old. I was getting ready to leave to go shopping for baby formula. I remember grabbing my son and standing in the doorway of the hotel bathroom, praying the 10 floors above us would not come crushing down. As soon as it was over, I called Greg and asked if I could come and hang out at his house. Of course, he said yes. It probably took an hour and a half to drive. When I arrived at his house, and this is when they were in Normandy Park at this time, Greg came walking out of his house through his garage. I got out of the car and he walked towards me. He then opened his arms to give me a big old bear hug, and that's when the stress of that morning finally hit me. I broke down in tears, sobbing, and most likely was babbling incoherently. He hugged me and talked to me until I finally stopped crying. He told me what it was like at work when the earthquake hit there. They immediately got under their desks and stayed there until the earthquake stopped. He described the way the concrete floor just rolled up and down like the waves of the ocean or the movement of a waterbed when you first get onto it. As Greg is talking to me, in my mind, I'm trying to imagine him fitting under a desk. In all scenarios that ran through my head, there's not one where his back end is not sticking out. That image in my mind caused me to laugh and calmed me down. I told Greg I still needed baby formula, so off we went to the local grocery just down the street, praying it would be opened. To our surprise, the grocery store was actually still open. We walked into the store, took maybe 20 steps, and I swear it was Greg who was now struggling to hold back tears. To the left of us, the racks were empty. Every single one. The shelves were barren. One after another lined up like soldiers. Based on the expression on Greg's face, you would have thought that the sight that lay before us was straight out of a horror movie. He looked at me, shook his head, and said something about it being a tragedy and walked away. You see, we entered the store through the wine section. All the bottles of wine had fallen off the shelves. The floor was littered with broken glass and wine was spilled everywhere. The scene before us looked like a civil war had occurred between the Chardonnays and the Cabernets, the Rieslings and the Merlots, and the store employees were in the process of cleaning up the carnage. I swear to this day, Greg was wiping tears away as he turned to go down another aisle. In closing, the bumble. At some point in our relationship, I started calling Greg by a nickname. I called him Bumble, or I referred to him as the Bumble. Sometimes I referred to the entire family as the Bumbles. If you don't know what a bumble is, it's that big snow monster from that Christmas movie, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. I suppose if you think about it, they had a lot of similarities. Greg and the character were both physically big, larger than life, intimidating in their size. They're both hairy, except for the top of Greg's head. But most importantly, they both are kind-hearted, gentle giants wanting to do good in the world. I've known Greg for almost 33 years. The Bumble was there for me during the happiest times of my life, as well as the most sad, angst-ridden time of my life. I don't think Greg knew this, but I have a Christmas ornament of a Bumble. I can't even remember how long I've had it, but it's been a long time. Every year it gets hung on my Christmas tree. When I put it on my Christmas tree, every single memory of Greg comes rushing back in my mind. They flash by so quickly, and it always, always puts a smile on my face. This year will be different, however. I'll still put the bumble on my tree. I'm sorry. But try as hard as I might, because I know Greg wouldn't want them, there will be many, many tears of sadness along with the smiles. I know for a fact that one day we will meet again, and I know that Greg is watching us today. They say you can't take your possessions with you, which is very much true, but what they don't specifically tell you is that you can take your memories. I am so appreciative of all the memories I have of the Bumble. It was an absolute honor and privilege to know, to love, and to be loved by the Bumble. I miss you, Greg, and I love you very, very much. I know we will meet again. To those of you here today, if you have or have had your own version of a Bumble in your life, then you know exactly what I'm talking about. To those of you who have never had the joy of having a Bumble in your life, I'd highly recommend it.
Hi, I'm a person that was privileged to meet Greg through our work at Boeing. And I didn't know Greg for 33 years or anything, but they were great years. And I was about 18, something like that.
I don't like microphones. Greg is a big, burly guy, and at work he had quite a reputation. You know, when he knew he was right, you were not going to change his mind, and he would get very vocal about that. But he and I developed a real friendship. And one time we were working in South Carolina, staying in a nice hotel, and we were going down to dinner in this restaurant. So Greg and I go down there, and here we are, two pretty good-sized guys. It's summer, it's very hot, but we're in our shorts and t-shirts. We are not dressed up. And we go to this table, and we start talking about work, and our conversation revolved and went to our daughters and our family. Our daughters in particular, because I shared with Greg that my daughter at the time was in her second pregnancy, and she had had a couple miscarriages prior to that, and she was having some issues. And so we talked about that, and Greg talked about his daughters, and he leans over and says, Earl, do you think we should pray? And we said, yes. So here we are in this nice restaurant, people all around us. We're holding hands, t-shirts and sweatshirts and shorts. We pray, and we get up, give each other a hug. Not just a knock your shoulder hug. We gave each other a big hug, and then we leave the restaurant. And Greg had gotten emotional talking about our daughters. His daughter's christening meant a lot to him, and he started tearing up a little bit. So here we are. We get up after doing this, and people are looking at us, and we walked out, our arms over each other's shoulders, just went there. We shared a real moment, and that really is when we bonded really tightly. Even though I'd known him a short time, we worked together, many projects, lots of travels, and Greg was always awesome. And he was, like many people have said, huge heart. He might seem gruff, but he had a huge heart. He was a great friend. And it was an honor when he said, Earl, we're brothers from a different mother. So, I'm gonna miss him.
My name is Thomas, and I came late to the Bunger Parade. I don't know exactly how, but somehow Greg learned that I specialized in doing work with Boeing employees and using precious metals instead of stocks. And he came to me. And the fact that he came to me and asked me to help him to establish his long-term retirement plan was a true act of honor. I didn't know him. I didn't know him well at all. But as a result, we became very close. I was amazed at the amount of love that that man was willing to express. Openly, without hesitancy, he would hold me by the cheeks and say, "Man, I love you." That's not common. But he did it, and he did it regularly. I was responsible for the church's food outreach, and Greg would come every week to volunteer, to be a helper. And I could tell that there was some limitations, and when you've been 75 years, you kind of get the insight as to who's capable of what. And he just felt like he had endless energy and that there was no limitations, but I would just kind of casually tell him, "Well, I think this job would be better for you." And as he became a bit, I knew nothing about his fragilities, but he did start to slow down. And so I would give him lesser and lesser tasks until finally he was responsible for overseeing a table and dealing with the people that would come to that table, and he was in his element. He would minister to them. He would love on them. He'd reach out, and he just loved talking to the people. The last couple of weeks of his life, I guess I became better acquainted with him, other than the fact that he adored me. In the hospital, and we would spend time together and give Christine a break and spend time just praying and praising God and anticipating what the immediate future, and he knew in his mind, this is what the immediate future looks like. I spent my entire life seeking for this moment where he crosses over. And it was a delight to be his friend. As short and abbreviated as it was a delight. And I'll miss the guy, but I'm going to stay close to the family. There's just something lovable about them that you just don't want to cut loose. And so I'm going to end up being a hassle, probably, but I'm going to be around. So, at any rate, bless the Bungers. Bless Greg. The man is home. I'll tell you what, I'll miss him, but I'm hanging on looking for the opportunity when I get to cross over. So, glory. Amen. Thank you. And I really appreciate this turnout here. The man was obviously adored.
Well, I appreciate everybody being here so we can honor a great man. My name is Robbie Corson. I'm married to Catherine Rose Corson, Greg's and Christine's firstborn. Not much of a public speaker, and I'm definitely going to have a hard time not crying, but let's do this. I practiced this before everybody got here. It didn't help. Anyway, I just wanted to share some of my inner dialogue with you as I wrestle with and process in my own life, or my own life in relation to Greg's returning to his father. I think of Greg as a person whose default starting point is joy and contentment. There is one word that keeps coming to my thoughts: honor. Greg gave honor and glory to God, and Greg was worthy of honor. I've known plenty of good, honorable women in my life. They don't ever make the headlines, and Greg is one of these. There are many backwards and upside down ideas in our culture. One of these ideas is that well-behaved people do not make history. The implications of that statement is misleading. The truth is that a foundation of a house is rarely considered or taken notice of. The foundation of any building is in its design place, bearing an unbelievable weight, while it creates a stable, strong base so that the house can fulfill its purpose of shelter, comfort, and beauty. Men like Greg are the quiet pillars giving stability to this nation. As a father, I can tell you that I've discovered there are no perfect parents, but we do try hard. As a man, that I can tell you that despite hearing fallacies like men are selfish and oppressive, the reality is that it takes 777 small choices every single day to try to be the man that God desires me to be. Greg's heart opened to Jesus as he became a man. He worked hard till he established a career. Then he didn't just punch in and pray for Friday. He learned, he grew, he elevated his life and his family's life. He became an important part of a large company, and he had a drive as big as he was. He raised a family with Christine, which he was very proud of. He was always talking and teaching. It's true, he was a mountain of a man. A man like Greg could have been a perpetual victim his whole life because of his childhood years. Or he could have been a hell-raising terror to society. But he chose every day to become the foundation of his family and community. Big Papa Bunger, Greg the Big Teddy Bear, he didn't slip and fall into being this kind of man. He made thousands of choices guided by his love of Jesus to step into his role. In a day and age of lost identity and uncertainty, he was unswayed by the daily changes of morals, but he stood firm. He didn't always say the right thing, and thank God for that. It's through talking that we process thoughts and ideas. We refine, tweak, evolve, and share those ideas. Anytime that I hung out with Greg, I knew I could expect stories and great conversation. Greg was excited when I came into his family. He finally had a son. And he treated me as his son, an unearned position of honor in his family. The way that Chris and Greg treated me gives me something to strive towards. Greg was a firm foundation worthy of honor. Instead of being sad for the fishing trips that we won't have, I will try and be grateful for the ones that we did. I will try to remember that he is in his place of honor as a faithful saint in God's kingdom. Thank you, Greg, for your patience, forgiveness, wisdom, love, and great food. Say hi to Dad, and I'll be there in a little while.
Hello, my name is Christopher Chacon. I'm married to Kimberly. So I'm gonna keep it short and sweet. So what can I say? So I came here to Washington, I don't know, it was about maybe 13, 14 years ago, I don't know. I came out here for school. And then I met Kim, and then life started, and we had our family, and we, you know, here we are. And, you know, People change. Everybody changes. I'm not going to say it was always rainbows and butterflies, because it wasn't. Our relationship was a little strained at time. We were just different individuals from different walks of life. But just to give you a little background of myself, I just grew up with my mother. I didn't have any siblings. I never met my father. So I was kind of always a little bit, I've always been a little bit kind of a little bit of a loner and a little bit standoffish, you know. But then when I came to learn about Greg's background, it was, I don't know, it was a lot to process, because it explained a lot why, how he was the way he was. And we had a lot of similarities as well, which was pretty interesting. And he was an individual who really understood the fear and love of God. And I grew up, my mom, when I was about 8 or 9, she became a born-again Christian, and she raised me in the church. And whenever he and I would talk about scripture, or he would start talking about God, he was an individual who was very knowledgeable, and he was very passionate about it. And I was as well, because of the way that I was raised. So I would always kind of just quiet down and listen to him, you know, because I knew that he was, you know, giving wisdom. And I tell my kids all the time that when I'm giving them advice or talking to them about life, or somebody's doing that to them, it's like somebody's giving you like a gold coin or like a diamond or something precious that you can either cherish and put in your treasure chest or whatever it is that you want to call it, or you just can toss it on the ground and walk on and it doesn't mean anything. So a lot of times when Greg would talk, I would listen, you know. I would listen to what he had to say. And it was for the majority, I agreed. I agreed a lot with it, you know. But then the times that we didn't agree, I was taught to be respectful to my elders. So, you know, I was always very respectful to him. And I always, you know, even though we didn't agree, we'd kind of take a little break and then we'd talk again, you know. And that was part of a healthy relationship. But he was a good man. He was a very good man, and I was very happy to have met him. And I was very, you know, even happier that I was able to meet his daughter, and we've been able to build a family together. And like I said, I came from just being in a one single parent household. You know, I was not used to a lot of people, so. When we started, when Levi was born, our firstborn, and then Caleb came along, you know, I was getting more integrated into Kimberly's, like into Greg's family, and it took a while for me to get used to it. You know, it took a while, and but slowly but surely, kind of, sometimes as the family was growing, I could see Greg just kind of sit in his recliner, and he'd just sigh. And he'd be like, yeah, let the chaos ensue, you know. So I kind of, at first, I didn't quite get it. But then now that I'm getting older and I'm getting there, and I kind of, I guess I'm following in my journey, I understand that. But this is a very surreal thing for me. I don't have a lot of experience with death. So it's just the concept of knowing that somebody was here and then that they're not here anymore physically is something that I'm trying to process. He was a loved man. He was a great man, and I was very honored to have been able to be part of his life for a little bit, and then to be part of his family's life. So thank you.
So I wasn't prepared to come up here right now. Sorry about that. Apparently there has been a change in plans. we're running a little bit over, and we want to make sure you all have plenty of time to eat the wonderful food next door. We do have a whole video tribute that we are going to play for you today. It will be playing on loop in the brick building next door. I'm Kimberly. I'm sure you guys all know I'm one of Greg's daughters. And this is Kate.
Hello.
She doesn't like to talk so much in front of people, but I can do enough talking for the both of us. Anyone who knows me knows that's
she can.
Probably true. But she'll interrupt me a lot, too. if you heard all of the other speakers, you already know a lot about my dad today that you maybe didn't know beforehand, and all about who he is. But one thing that was touched on a few times and I feel like is a big part of who my dad was is his family, and he was very proud of that. And I know you guys know us as his only children. That is not the case.
No.
I was originally going to ask anyone here in this room who has been affected by my father or thinks of him in a father-like figure or mentor in any way, shape, or form, please stand up. I know there's like eight of them right now that are all in the nursery helping watch my one-year-old. They're all waving if you want to look. But I mean, you can just look around and see. And it's not just about saying that he was a father figure, it's that he was. And any single one of these people, you could come up and ask if they had something, their dishwasher wasn't working, or their laundry machine, or they wanted to chop some wood and didn't know where to find it. They call my dad, and he goes, "All right, let me put my shoes on." It was never a question of, "Hey, I'm doing something else," or, "Hey, I'm busy right now. Maybe I'll get back to you next week." It was, "Where do you need me to be?"
Yeah.
"Okay, I'll be there." "You stopped on the side of the road?" "All right, I'll do that." "You don't know where you were, and you woke up in a strange area? Okay, what's around you? Let me come help find you." And it didn't matter if it was me or her or any of the number of people that you just saw standing a minute ago. He didn't live his life for himself. He lived it for God, but he also lived it for all of us. And we're going to be his legacy because we need to pass that forward. Mm-hmm. Pay it forward, right?
Yeah.
So we need to BPB it forward. Everyone, and BPB, if you didn't already hear from Robbie, is Big Papa Bunger. That was coined by one of his many children. I don't think he was able to be here today, but ever since that's it, we just call him BPB. So on the back of the flyer, if you know, you know, it's RIP BPB, I think is what we wrote. That's about it. One of the other things that my dad always loved, whether or not we were prepared for it or able to do it, is he wanted to always hear us sing together. And over the last decade or so, and a lot of people here, we've kind of become known in our family as the funeral singers. And that sounds horrible, but we're asked to sing, it's true, we're asked to sing Amazing Grace. Do you have them?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. We're asked to sing Amazing Grace at the funerals, and my dad always loved that. And although I don't think that I'm up to it today, and Kate, I'm sure, is in agreement. So we're
it's going to be a little tough, so we're just asking that everybody joins in with us and sings along.
Please, everyone. So on the pamphlet, we wrote all voices for a reason.
Yes.
We don't want it to be us. So, oh, you get your own microphone. Look.
Hello.
Oh, it's not on though. That's okay.
Can you hear me? Hello?
Oh, I think he's doing it. Okay. All right. We had.
Hello? Oh, yep, there I am.
There's words up here, so everyone
yes.
can sing along, please.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am There's grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Twas grace that's brought me safe this far. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be. As long as life endures, when we bright shining as the sun, we know less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun.
A dad's family says a lot. You guys have a beautiful family. It's a huge tribute in itself to Greg. And I couldn't help smiling the whole time. It's such a perfect picture, kind of presiding like, that was okay. That was pretty good. Can we all stand? We're going to go ahead and end. Oh, one thing, somebody lost a silver eagle or a buffalo round. I thought as much. I think the food arrived at 2:30, so if we can just kind of quickly exit, no trampling, but so, and the food, if you go out the front, just go right down past the big white building to the brick building on the end, and we will have what Greg would be happy that we're having. So Father, we thank you today for Greg's life. What a beautiful, amazing life. And Lord, we want to let him be our inspiration today and be everything you've called us to be. And we thank you for all of this. We pray you will surround Christine, Greg's daughters, grandchildren, that you'll surround them. And we thank you that you will, in Jesus' name. Amen. So we'll be dismissed. And I want to say one last thing. The one thing that Christine and their family can't create anymore of our memories. So share those with them. and put an alarm in your phone or calendar for 60 days, 90 days, and 5 months to call Christine. Everything happens a lot right here, but make a point to remember in the weeks ahead also. God bless you. Thank you all for coming.